Good morning and Happy New Year to everyone, and welcome to the first meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2023. And can I remind those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent, please. Just to say that Mercedes Villalba will be joining us approximately 10 a.m. Our single item of business today is to take evidence on the 2023-24 Scottish Government Budget. And I welcome to the meeting Marie Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and her supporting officials, George Burgess, the Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy, Erica Clarkson, Joint Head of Division Rural and Island Futures, Shetal Mahara, excuse my pronunciations, Head of Strategic Engagement for Budget and Spending Review, and Ian Wallace, Marine Scotland Head of Strategy and Change. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. When I appeared before the committee in October, I set out the priorities for the Rural Affairs and Islands portfolio, and I'm pleased to come back today to set out how the 23-24 Scottish Budget presented by the Deputy First Minister to Parliament in December supports those priorities. This budget, of course, takes place in the most turbulent economic and financial context that I think probably most people can remember. And it therefore demands a response from government that supports the most vulnerable and which ultimately helps build a sustainable economy. That's why we've chosen a progressive path for this budget, investing in our people, our economy and our public services. The resource and capital spending review sets out, as best we could at the time, the spending priorities of this government and the high-level financial parameters for portfolio envelopes. However, a lot has changed in the months since those reviews were published. We've had two fiscal events from the UK government which have both had a direct impact on Scotland and its economy. The autumn statement in November fell short of the interventions that Scotland needs to guide us through this cost crisis. And this means that we still continue to feel the impacts of the most severe economic upheaval in our generation, and we will continue to do so for some time. Despite this, our spending reviews, our programme for government, the emergency budget review and the 23-24 budget all show that this government is determined to act. We are focused on eradicating child poverty, creating sustainable public services and transforming our economy to net zero. We don't view these as three competing objectives. We view them as priorities that are linked together. And while it is true that this government hasn't been able to do everything that we would have wanted to do at the pace we would have wanted, we have taken action to support those priorities. In relation to the Rural Affairs and Islands budget, the spend of this portfolio supports some of our most fragile communities, businesses and sectors at a time when they're feeling the effects of multiple shocks, recovering from the pandemic, Brexit and are, of course, now dealing with the significant challenges of the cost crisis. As I did in 22-23, I will prioritise the direct cash injection my portfolio makes in rural and island areas and across the agriculture and marine sectors. £650 million will continue to be invested across these sectors, providing much needed economic stability. Our commitment to supporting the ambitions for our islands remains strong, with £8.5 million allocated from the portfolio for the Islands Programme and the Carbon Neutral Islands Project. We are living in a global climate and nature emergency, with climate change and a loss of biodiversity among the greatest threats facing people and our planet. So we are dedicated to our critical work with the agricultural sector to co-develop and deliver on our vision for agriculture, investing over £44 million over the course of 2023-2024 to help Scotland become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. We're also delivering a new round of agri-environment support with over £36 million planned investment over the coming year. The Blue Economy Vision for Scotland sets out the long-term outcomes that we want to see for our marine environment, for people and our economy. This work, together with the £14 million increase in Marine Scotland's budget, is representative of this government's commitment to net zero and enhancing biodiversity through the expansion of offshore renewables, climate-related research and environmental protection. We are, of course, living in extremely difficult times, and as we look ahead, there are still many challenges to overcome. And this makes the budget and allocating funding between priorities extremely and increasingly difficult. But I am confident that the balance this government has achieved is the right one, and I will continue working across Scottish Government and with our partners across Scotland to support and deliver for our rural, coastal and island communities. So thank you, Convener, and I'm of course happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to kick off. We've got some fairly ambitious plans for agriculture and marine when it comes to climate change and biodiversity, and also we're very aware of the pressures facing island communities with depopulation and so on. So it's a very simple question, but maybe doesn't have a simple answer. What are the practical implications of the current inflationary pressures on the Rural Affairs budget, and how are you going to deal with that?
Probably isn't too much of a simple answer, but I mean, we know, I know that all members of the committee will be aware, we all see right across our constituencies the impact that the cost crisis is having on our communities, and particularly the rural communities and island communities that members represent, and the impact, the resulting impact that that's had on our budget is of course huge. And as I said in my opening statement, how we then allocate between our different priorities is of course an increasingly difficult challenge as our budgets become more stretched. But I think if you look at the overall figures and some of what we're dealing with here, so from the Barnett funding, we did have an increase in overall funding of £1.7 billion. But when you look at what that means in real terms, we're actually seeing a reduction of 4.8% since 2021. So of course that means that there is huge pressure, not just within my budget and therefore what I'm able to do across the Rural and Islands portfolio, but right across the Scottish Government too. And I think when you look at particularly in my portfolio as well and what that equates to, obviously we've left the EU and the EU replacement funding, we've seen that fall by 1.7% over the course of this last year and since 2022-23. But since 2021, that's decreased by 12.7%. So obviously we don't have the same spending power that we would have previously had, and all of that has an impact. But that's what I hope, as I'd said in my opening statement, again, the priorities that I'd set out to the committee in October and what we're continuing to provide in relation to that cash injection, that £650 million across which it impacts our agriculture and marine, maintaining those payments, I think, is absolutely vital and in trying to provide some of that stability too.
Okay, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, we're talking about a budget in the context of massive inflationary pressure. And obviously, that pressure applies to individual farmers just as it applies to the government. How are you planning in the coming year to work within the constraints that imposes on you, given what we've had, without rehearsing history, a parade of chancellors, unprecedented levels of inflation in recent years? How do you plan for this budget in the coming year in those circumstances?
In terms of some of the issues that you've raised there, we have seen that particularly in our agriculture sector, just the costs of whether that's energy, fuel and feed costs as well, where they have absolutely spiralled. So what we've tried to do within that, and I think against the turbulence and the backdrop of what we've experienced, is try to provide that stability. So I talked about the £650 million and that direct cash injection that we've been making to in both agriculture and marine. So over the course of this current financial year, of course, the committee will be aware that we'd brought forward the payments that we'd made, the direct payments, making them at their earliest ever stage. So we commenced those payments in September. And I think from the latest figures that I've had, we've paid over £411 million to over 17,000 businesses. So that's over 98% of businesses have received that vital cash injection. And what I've set out in the budget as well, I think, is again shows that stability and why we're trying to maintain that and give that message to farmers that this is what they will be receiving, and being clear about those figures and trying to maintain that and keep that consistent as possible. And hopefully that does help provide some of that certainty and stability.
And finally, Convener, if I know everyone throughout all sectors, not just our budget area, looks to move toward longer term budgeting and so on. But given the uncertainty from month to month that we've experienced at the UK end, and given our dependence in terms of the budget on what's happening there, I'm just trying to find an idea of the predicament that the Scottish Government is in terms of planning. How does any attempt to move to longer term planning, how is that possible?
That's the thing. It is really difficult at the moment, and it isn't possible because we have annual budgets and annual allocations. And I know that is it continues to be an issue. And I know that can be, particularly for some of the schemes that we've run and we've funded, I know that that's a particularly difficult thing for people. But we are trying to, I think that's where we've had the resource spending review, the capital spending review, even though they are not budgets in and of themselves, but to provide that overall envelope. But of course, that can vary year to year as we go through the annual budget setting process. But I think to try, and what we are trying to do within the portfolio as well is work. I think when you look at the islands funding in particular, and I know that's been an issue and something that's been called for, is how we can look at multi-year allocations. We are trying to work to see how some of those, how we can improve some of the processes that we have to make that process to give people as much warning as possible as we can. But of course, that will always depend on what the allocation is going to be year to year, unfortunately. But we are trying to work to improve these processes and give that clarity where it's possible to do that.
Thank you, Convener.
Rachel Hamilton.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. In your portfolio, we've seen a large number of the budget lines with the real terms cut. We've had a record breaking block grant. How do you make the case for Scotland's agricultural and farming sector, and to whom do you make it, and to which areas did you pitch if you did make it?
Well, I think that while you talk about the increase in funding that we've received from the UK government, I mean, as I outlined in one of my previous responses as well, I mean, what that equates to since 2021 is a 4.8% cut. And I think especially given the inflationary pressures that we've seen, I think inflation had hit 11.1% in October. So that, of course, means that is whatever increase we've had is always going to be worth less. And when we look at the EU replacement funding,
apply to a wider funding as part of the block grant in your role. I realise that there's ring-fenced funding, but that's for broad agricultural support. And you have discretion to make those choices. But my question is, as part of the record block grant, do you have the ability to make your case for Scotland's agricultural sector?
We would always continue to do that, like both within my portfolio and across government too. But as you can imagine, and with some of the inflationary pressures that I've talked about as well, this pressure doesn't exist within my portfolio alone, but right across government, where we are seeing, it's as I said in my opening statement too, we can't do everything that we would want to do at the pace we would want to do it because a lot of these pressures that we're up against as well. But I think I also need to point out as part of that as well, that we're not getting the full replacement EU funds that we had been promised by the UK government. And also what we are getting in replacement funds from the UK government is coming through as resource rather than as resource and capital, which we previously received as part of the EU. So that adds then more pressure on an already stretched capital budget, which is why, again, we haven't been able to do everything that we would want to do. And we've seen that fall. I talked about that in my opening response, I think, 1.7% from the last from this current financial year, but that's 12.7% from 2021. We were also meant to have, as part of the discussions with the UK government after leaving the EU, a discussion about future allocations and how that would work. However, despite continually raising that with the EU government, those conversations have never taken place.
Okay. Convener, would it be okay if I ask the Cabinet Secretary to give detail of the EMF funding of the £62 million, which I presume you're using as the calculation that you're working out that of money that you should have got, but that's should have got. But as we know, when we left the European Union, that money increased. That was calculated as part of that rather than what we were receiving before. So it'd be really useful for the committee to receive the calculation that you've made as to how you came to the figure.
Oh, yeah, I'd be happy to provide that to the committee.
Great.
Yeah. Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, team. We've heard that in the emergency budget review from Mr Swinney, there's going to be savings of over £60 million made from the Rain budget, including £33 million from rural support. And, you know, we all know the problems. We know there's a cost of living crisis. And to be fair, the Scottish Government have given early payment to Elfast to help the rural community get funding into their system. But is there any way that you can tell us what's happening with the £33 million of ring fence funding, and if and when it is going to come back into the Rain budget?
Yes, well, I think as part of what I'd outlined to committee when I previously appeared, there were about over £60 million worth of savings from the portfolio that had gone forward at that time. The biggest part of that was, of course, the convergence funding. I think I outlined that in the letter that I'd sent to committee about the budget as well in relation to the £33 million. That was an amount of funding that we'd received unexpectedly, so, of course, we hadn't budgeted for that. That's part of the ring fence funding that we received, so it has to come back to the portfolio in future years. It hasn't been returned for the 23-24 financial year, but of course that will be. I will be discussing that further with the Deputy First Minister so when that money will be returned to the portfolio. But it will be returned, but it won't be for the coming financial year, but in future years.
Okay, thank you, Camilla.
Okay, we're going to now move on to agricultural funding and reform specifically. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along today. As you've pointed out in your opening statement, and other colleagues have mentioned it as well, the Scottish budget is under huge pressure because of, I think you talked about Brexit, cost of living, increased inflation, and that's impacting on how you can support fragile communities. Representing Argyll and Bute, I've had a lot of farmers speaking to me about how it's impacting on their businesses, whether that's increased fuel charges through transportation and also operating their businesses, increased fertiliser costs and also feed costs as well, all going up. So I'm wondering if you could perhaps kind of expand on the response that you gave to my colleague Alistair Allen about how the Scottish Government is working with farmers and crofters to support them in this situation, and perhaps give examples of how the Rural Affairs and Islands budget is doing this as these business costs are increasing.
Absolutely. As I said previously, we are trying to provide as much clarity, certainty and stability as possible, because recognising the turbulence and some of the challenges that businesses are facing in particular, and we know in our agriculture sector those pressures are really acute at the moment because of all the reasons that we've talked about. So that's why we had tried to bring forward payments to make them at their earliest ever rate to help with that cash flow, which we know has been an issue, and why we're continuing to provide that stability over the coming financial year as well. So I talked about the funding that we've already paid out through the basic payment scheme and greening. So there's over £424 million allocated towards that as well. With Elfast has been mentioned as well, the £65.5 million that we're getting out the door in relation to those payments too. And I think looking to the coming financial year and the budgets that we've got in place for that as well, you touched on crofting as well, which I think it's really important to mention some of the schemes that we are continuing to fund and look at again, which I think help with that cash injection to those communities. We have the crofting, the housing grant scheme, the agricultural grant scheme as well. There's also the extra funding that we've provided to the Crofting Commission to try and deal with some of the particular issues that we know that we have in relation to crofting too. So that's how we're intending to provide that support, and as I say, try and provide as much stability and clarity as we can through what is a really challenging time.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I think the key thing is talking about transformation. And I've had a few conversations with Nature Friendly Farming about work that they're doing, working together and trying to find new ways of operating and what support. And I think there's an article in The Guardian today about woodland crofting as well, and how people are looking at new ways of trying to work. And so interested to hear how you're working with these organisations and Quality Meat Scotland, for example, as well, with the Monitor Farms, one of which is on Isla. So just be interested to hear your thoughts on how the Scottish Government, given the constraints of the budget, is able to look at transformational ways of people changing the way that they are working and spreading that out across the country, perhaps.
Well, first of all, thank you for mentioning the Monitor Farm Network, which I neglected to mention in my response, but I think that that was an initiative I was really excited to announce, and that's £1.4 million worth of funding that we'll be providing for that programme over the course of the next few years, which I think is really exciting. We know that the Monitor Farm programme works in terms of the engagement that it encourages, sharing that knowledge and that expertise, so being able to continue with that and have another round of that has been really important too. And of course we've done that with agritourism as well, which again I think is really important to see that really exciting part of the sector continue to grow and develop. So of course we are continuing to invest through schemes such as, well, we're funding the Monitor Farm programme through the Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund, so we're continuing to provide funding through that as well. Through the Agri Environment Climate Scheme, we have £36 million invested in that over the course of the coming year. Some of those other schemes that I've talked about as well. But I think it's also important to, you mentioned the Nature Friendly Farming Network, so I've had quite a lot of engagement with them. I think it's a fantastic network, and it's really important for us, I think, to, we do, I of course have regular engagement with our key stakeholders. We also have an agriculture, biodiversity and climate change network that we're encouraging people to get involved with, to really share that knowledge and expertise that we have. And that's where we really have tried with this budget to continue. I said that one of the priorities in my opening statement was about that transformation to net zero and becoming a net zero economy. We know that we have to fund that. We need to help with that transition where we can. And that's why we've provided the funding across these various different schemes to continue on with that work and really invest that and drive that change that we want to see and ultimately deliver on our vision for agriculture too.
Thank you. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton. Jim, and a supplementary?
Yes, please. Could you possibly give us a wee update on the Crofting and Agricultural Grant Scheme and how it's helping, based on the question that Jenny Minto has just asked?
Yes, I think between that and also the Crofting Housing Grant Scheme as well, in relation to the overall figures, I'm sure that George can perhaps jump in on that, but that is vital funding. We want to see the continuing development of crofting and to do what we can. We know that people are crofting some of the most remote and rural parts of Scotland, and there are particular challenges there. That's why through the various schemes that we have, we're funding things like increasing energy efficiency, looking at home improvements, and really trying to do what we can to help crofters through these schemes. Sorry, George, I don't know if there was anything you wanted to add in relation to that.
I think Cabinet Secretary has pretty much covered it, but certainly on the Croft House Grant Scheme, as well as in the past, we've covered development of croft houses, but the new scheme will have a specific element about energy efficiency, because many of the croft houses are not the most energy efficient, and this will be a direct way of helping crofters to save money. Maybe just going back to the earlier point about direct help to farmers, an important part of our programme is the provision of soil testing. Now that's an example where we're helping farmers to understand the specific state and needs of their soils, and in turn that can reduce the amount of inorganic fertiliser that they require to apply. The cheapest fertiliser is the fertiliser you're not having to buy in the first place.
Alistair Allen, like to come in and supplement in the...
Thank you, Commissioner. Yes, on CAGS, with regard to crofting again, on CAGS scheme, have you figures to hand as to how many crofters have been assisted with that in the last year or the last period?
We have about 900 applications each year, so that gives you a sense of the number.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, well, my first question is, Cabinet Secretary, quite simply, why has the Agricultural Transformation Scheme been reduced from £45 million to £5 million?
I think we've actually seen, when you look at what we're doing in relation to agricultural transformation, an increase in the budget this year in comparison to last year. And when you look at the overall climate change related spend and what we're investing over the course of this year, we're up £19 million on what we had been over the course of the previous year as well. That covers the investment between our sustainable agricultural capital grant scheme, the agri-environment climate scheme as well.
So why isn't that shown in the budget? Why continue with the Agricultural Transformation Fund if you're rolling it all into the rest of that? I actually don't understand your explanation there.
Are you saying
that one has been replaced by another?
No, and that's the thing. I'd be happy to provide a further breakdown of those figures, and I'm not rolling one thing into the other. We have the Sustainable Agricultural Grant Scheme, which is a capital fund of £5 million. That's what we've put forward for the coming financial year. It was also £5 million over the, well, within the current financial year as well. So that fund in particular has been used for slurry spreading equipment, slurry store covers as well. That's the particular focus of that fund over that past year. We've budgeted £5 million for the coming financial year, but we will of course be providing more details of that when this fund and the scheme launches.
Well, actually, particularly on the agri-environment climate scheme, I know that the NFU were really disappointed because the slurry storage scheme, the farmers are trying to do their best to comply and, you know, to meet the rules around that. But don't you think that unless the Scottish Government keep pace with that budget, that farmers will not be able to keep pace with those requirements?
I absolutely agree, and to be honest, if I could put a lot more into that capital scheme, then I absolutely would. But I think because of the challenges that I'd outlined in my previous responses and where we are with our capital budget, and we haven't seen that replacement funding come through, that's what's made this particularly challenging. So that's why I know that the first round of the capital grant scheme that we had in agriculture was very popular. Because we had reduced capital allocations, we had to really target that scheme where we thought we'd have the most effect, which is why we focused it on those items in particular, and where we are looking to trying to fund those pieces of equipment that we know will have the biggest impact. But of course, I would always welcome more funding and a bigger capital allocation, because of course we would then be able to do more with that. But as it stands, and with the budget that I have, and in relation to capital, we have to use it as best we can and target it the best way that we can.
Yeah, I appreciate the difficulties that the government might have in targeting support. But what assessment has been made of the need for specific support to those who are finding it difficult to access? I mean, how are you actually going to achieve what you want to achieve? How is the government going to achieve what it wants to achieve if it cannot give targeted support to very different farmers across Scotland? I mean, how are we going to actually achieve this if we don't put some allocation to it?
Yeah, but that's what I think. I mean, I've focused on the capital grant scheme in particular, but that's where the other funds that we have are really important, because like you say, not all businesses are the same. We have a variety right across Scotland, and that's where the support that we offer needs to be flexible to that as well. As I say, that fund in particular had to be targeted for the reasons that I've outlined. But that's where the other schemes that we have are also really important in terms of enabling that transformation and allowing people to take part in that, as you've outlined as well. So the AIC scheme, I think, is an example of that as well. So I've outlined we have £36 million for that for the coming financial year. And the funds that we have through that, the work that we're trying to do through the National Test Programme as well, and encouraging that uptake and trying to incentivise people to take part in, you know, as George just had outlined, the soil testing, undertaking carbon audits. We're looking to incentivise these practices as much as we possibly can, and fund and incentivise that where we can as much as possible. But that particular scheme is one that we've had to target where we think it will have the biggest effect.
Okay. I'm not really satisfied because I think that the government should look at a different way that is flexible. I mean, I think you're giving all the right words here, and I think you understand the problems, Cabinet Secretary. But I think from my assessment of this, it would be better to look at a new way to achieve what the government are trying to achieve, particularly on the carbon audits. And I'm sure that other people in the committee will be asking questions around that, because it's been a very, very low uptake. And what we want is we want farmers to be able to have an easy to access system that allows them to support our ambitions to meet net zero and environmental targets. And I don't think we're there right now.
I would say that I absolutely agree with you, and we want to make it as easy as possible for people to take part and to be part of that transformation as well. You've touched on other people might want to come in on the carbon audits and the low uptake. Of course, we are really disappointed by that low uptake in the scheme that we've seen so far as well. But that's where the work that we've been undertaking with the Aerial Board has been important in helping us design schemes that are easy to access, that do offer the right incentives, which I believe is what we have provided that scheme, even though we haven't seen the uptake through it that we would want to see. I would just say in relation to that, though, that this is the first year of doing it. I think if the committee have any particular suggestions as to how we can either better communicate that, we have done our best in relation to working with all the various organisations and stakeholders that we have to get the message out as far as possible to explain what help and support is there. But of course, I'm happy to take any suggestions as to how that could be improved. But ultimately, the co-development and co-design process that we're working through at the moment for future policy is to help us get through some of these hurdles, because we don't want to put barriers and make this hard or make this transformation and some of the changes that we need to see difficult for our farmers and crofters. We want to make it as easy as possible, which is what we're trying to do through these schemes.
I'm going to bring in Ariane Burgess, because just to carry on that theme, unless Jenny, is it to do with the testing or?
Not specifically. I can supplement Ariane's question.
Okay,
thank you.
Right. Thank you, Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, yeah, so I wanted to pick up on the national test programme. So you mentioned that I think we're interested to hear what the funding for that will buy in 2023 to 2024, but also what will be anticipated to have been spent in 2022 to 2023. So you've mentioned that there's soil testing and there's carbon audits, and you've spoken to Rachel Hamilton, my colleague, about the low uptake, and that is a concern. And it would be interesting to understand maybe, you know, what are the barriers? And it sounds to me like some of it is just getting the word out to farmers is part of it, and that you're working through AREOP. But is it just soil testing and carbon audits that the funding is going to cover in the National Test Programme, or is there anything else that's being rolled out?
No, the ultimate ambition with that is to expand the programme. So the carbon audits and the soil testing were the first part of that. So we've been looking at animal health and welfare measures that could potentially be added to that as well in the programme. And also in coming years as well, we'd be looking to include biodiversity audits as part of that too. I know that that was something, and the strong feedback we received from the Aerial Board was about introducing biodiversity audits, but they're not in a state yet where they're ready to be rolled out at a national scale. But of course, at the point that we're ready to do that, we would be looking to include that as part of the programme as well. As I say, I think the uptake has been disappointing, but of course it is the first year of the programme. And when we were budgeting for that, it's a demand-led scheme, so we didn't know how big the uptake was going to be. We obviously want to be better prepared from that. It's better for us to be prepared and potentially than to have the opposite situation where we could be overspend a fund and then not be able to fund all the claims that we would receive as part of that. But all of that being said, I know I provided some of the figures within the letter to the committee. We've got a forecast for the first part of that for £2 million. That's how much we expect we could potentially spend through that, because we expect a lot of claims to come through at the tail end. I think George might want to expand on some of the discussions that we've had in relation to the feedback that we're hearing from agents. And also to give a picture on carbon audits overall, I think the uptake that we've seen on that this year has been really positive. So we also fund carbon audits through the Farm Advisory Service. And the budget for the Farm Advisory Service of that was actually exhausted in the summer this year, because there had been such a high uptake and an increase in demand in what they were seeing. So I think the fact that we've seen that has been really positive. And I think we will see more follow through. But I'll hand over to George. He'll be able to provide some more of the information.
Certainly, thanks. I mean, I wouldn't want the committee to think that the low uptake is in any way down to the complexity of the scheme mm-hmm. that we've got. I mean, I don't think anyone could design a simpler scheme. We don't require prior approval. Basically, the farmers can get the work done and then they claim it retrospectively. It's about as simple as you could possibly get it. And so that means that for this first year, farmers had until the end of December to do the work. They then got until the end of February to put their claim into us. So that it does make it difficult for us because we don't know exactly how many tests have actually been done. We won't know that until the end of February and the claim period. But we do know from our interaction with agricultural advisors, the colleges and others, that there's quite a lot that at the tail end of last year, there was quite a lot of activity out there. And also some farmers that might have chosen not to do it in the first year, but are interested in getting involved in this year.
Could you give us a sense of the upfront cost and effort for doing the work? And is it a small amount of money to have their land test, soil tested?
It's a small amount of money. The system we've got means that you do the work. You pay for it, you claim it back, but there's no delay in the claiming back. So as soon as the claims come in, they will be processed and paid. So I don't think there's any suggestion, and certainly there has been no suggestion from any farmers to us that the problem is anything about complexity or the fact that they might be lying out a couple of hundred pounds for a matter of a few weeks for the work. So I don't think there's a cost barrier there to the work.
Thanks for that clarification. Cabinet Secretary, the Bute House Agreement, in the Bute House Agreement, there's a commitment to double, at least double our organic land. And I just wonder where that fits in. Does that fit in? Soil testing, obviously, is part of moving to organics, understanding what is in your soil. I just wonder where the funding and the support for that would lie. Is it a natural fit in the National Test Programme? And also, is there scope for participation payments for people to start transitioning to organics? And does that sit in the National Test Programme, or is that in another funding pool?
As I said, in my response to Rachel Hamilton previously, I'm happy to write to the committee with some more information on each of the schemes, and if you would find that helpful.
That would be very helpful.
Just in outlining where the different support lies and what each of the different funds that we support, what they do and what they support. So that support doesn't fall within the National Test Programme, but it does fall within the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme that we support as well. So we have £36 million in the budget for the coming financial year in relation to that as well. So that's where we'd support that. But I would say that that's not the only work that we're doing in relation to organics. We've funded a post within Scotland Food and Drink to look at organics as well. And I've been engaging with stakeholders, looking at an action plan in relation to organics as well, because I think we do need to be doing more work in that space. But as for the support that's available at the moment, that's through the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme.
And then just on soil testing, and George, you mentioned, if we test the soil and understand what's in it, I think one of the concerns that's coming up for me is around nitrogen and runoff and pollution. Nitrates are a greenhouse gas, and I just wonder if you're kind of considering that in terms of talking to farmers and in the process of the soil testing, helping them understand how they can help to limit that contribution to our greenhouse gas emissions.
Absolutely. I mean, the testing is just the first stage of the process, understanding what the state of the soil is. That will then tell you, do you need to be adding more nitrogen through inorganic fertiliser or other means? And the more nitrogen that you can keep on the farm, supporting growth, rather than, in runoff or being lost to the atmosphere, the better. So, this is classic win-win. It's better for the farmer in terms of reduced cost, greater productivity. It's better for the environment as well. So the understanding through tunnel testing is the start, the key into that further work, that further conversation.
So just to clarify, so the soil testing occurs, and then are you following up with work around, rather than adding nitrogen through chemicals, actually plants that fix nitrogen in the soil, that kind of work?
That's going to depend on the individual circumstance of the farm, but yes, absolutely. You know, just doing the testing, it's not a case of you do the test and then you've done it, you stick that on the shelf. The same with the carbon audit. You know, it's not a done and that's it. The important part is what work that then leads into, mm-hmm. and you know, we've maintained the support for farm advisory services that will then be able to work with farmers to use the outcome of that testing in the development of their sort of farm business plans.
Mm-hmm. And these have been parts of the discussions that we've had are really important because somebody could tick a box and say that they've done that test, but as George was saying, it's what you then do with the information that you have is really important, and that's where those services are going to be vital going forward.
I think it would be great if, along with the list of all the funds that you have, it would be also interesting to hear obviously it's not exact for every farm because they run their businesses differently, but it would be interesting to hear if once a farmer has a test or a carbon audit, then what are the next steps in general that then they get the kind of feedback on? Okay, thanks.
Listen to this, it's quite bizarre. George, you talk the talk. Sounds all very good. Do the soil test, do the work after it, and you'll save money. It's all good. Improves climate change, includes biodiversity. And Cabinet Secretary, you talked about it's not just about ticking the box, but the sad fact is, up to the 12th of December, we only had 12 people tick the box. And we don't even know if those 12 people then went on to do the wonderful things and the right things that George talks about, so we don't even know that. So it seems bizarre, given there's funding for something which is the key to future profitability, future low-impact farming and so on, that we've had such a massively slow uptake. In the letter in the pre-budget meeting, you suggested that the National Test Programme had been slow, and that in carbon audits, whatever, with a mixture of feedback from the sector. What is the feedback from the sector? Why isn't it working? Because if it's a simple process, it results in far better farming, profitably wise for the farmer, for climate change, biodiversity. Why have we such a shockingly low uptake? And it can't just be about the lull in people doing the tests and claiming, because farmers are not renowned for doing something and not claiming the money back. So where has it all gone wrong?
I wouldn't say it's all gone wrong because, as I say, we're still waiting for the final figures for that. And, of course, I'll be happy to keep the committee updated on what those are. But, I mean, of course, we're really keen to get that feedback too. We want there to be, we've got that funding there. We want there to be as high uptake as possible and for people to be engaged. That's where we've worked extensively on communications, sending out, contacting farmers directly to make them know about.
You said you had a mixture of feedback from the sector. So where is the sector saying it's gone wrong? Because you admit it is way lower than expected. So what is the feedback telling you the reason? If it's not difficulty in accessing the scheme, if it's not about claiming, if it's not about farmers not recognising the benefits of doing it, where is it? Where is the problem that you're getting back hearing from the stakeholders?
Yeah, well, that's what I was coming to, because we are getting a variety of different feedback there. So based on, some of what George had touched on in his previous response as well, I mean, some people are planning to, well, from what we hear, people are planning to undertake the work, but they haven't done it yet, and they may do that in the coming year. It's to do with the capacity, I think, as well, for some agents in terms of carrying out that work has been an issue, but... George, you want to come in relation to some of the feedback we're receiving?
I think the Cabinet Secretary is right, and the feedback that we've got is that the agents are busy, the businesses carrying out the sort of soil testing and carbon audits are busy. I don't think we've had any feedback from the sector that says that the scheme isn't working.
But, of course, any of that feedback is important. And as I say, this is the first year of the scheme. So if there's lessons we can learn in terms of, I don't know, but I think that, as we're saying, I don't think the problem is accessibility to the scheme or the ability to claim, but it's trying to identify, well, where are these issues so that we can hopefully try and improve for the future years of the programme as well. Because, again, we want as many people to be involved as possible. We want to have them get on board. It's within our best interests to do that as well. So we want to work to make that happen.
Okay. Jenny Minto.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, kind of touching on what both Rachel Hamilton talked about and Ariane Burgess. and I appreciate this doesn't necessarily fall into your portfolio, Cabinet Secretary, but within Kintyre there's a work going on just now as a pilot looking at the slurry spreading and the capacity and the growth and the impact of runoff. So I think that's an example of where we have farmers that are wanting to find solutions, because I think, as George Burgess said, the cheapest fertiliser is what you don't have to pay for. So they want to understand the best use of what they are creating through their livestock. So I just wanted to add that in as well, just so you were across that.
And that's what I would say. Thanks very much for highlighting that example to me, and I'm happy to take a closer look at that if you want to contact me about it, because I think it's that sharing an example which is really important as well. And I touched on some of the networks that we have, because there is so much good work happening out there right across Scotland. I see it all the time when I'm out visiting different farm businesses. Again, we talked about the Monitor Farms and how important that work is. So I think that there are so many different networks and examples out there that people can engage with, and I would absolutely encourage them to do that. And like I say, we're more than happy to learn the lessons from this year of the programme, but I do think that sharing that learning and sharing that expertise is really vital.
Yeah. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. I wonder if I could ask you about the Agricultural Transformation Fund. There's £5 million allocated to that. I wonder if you could say a bit about what it is you're seeking to transform and how you would intend to spend that budget.
The £5 million budget that's been allocated for that is the Sustainable Agricultural Capital Grant Scheme. So in this current financial year, we've had £5 million available for that, which has funded slurry store covers as well as slurry spreading equipment as well. I think in relation to the utilisation of that fund as well, we had that we made about over 570 offers of grant and had pretty much exhausted that fund in terms of the grant offers that had been made. So we know that there has been really strong uptake in relation to that. Still to announce the details, I mean, providing the budget is agreed and that's passed, then of course we'd be looking to launch a scheme as well. But as to the details of that, that we'll be announcing that and in due course. But of course we'd be happy to keep the committee updated.
Thank you. It's helpful to have examples from last year and this year. But I wondered, as I say, if you could say a bit more about the name transformation suggests that there's something dramatic that you're looking to change in the way that agriculture is done, or is... Can you say a bit more about what the reasoning behind that budget is? Or?
Well, we know that there is a demand, and strong demand in particular, as I was talking about previously in my response to Rachel Hamilton's questions, I think for capital items that we know can make an impact. What we're looking to transform, of course, is we want to do what we can. As we've outlined in our vision for agriculture, we want Scotland to be that global leader when it comes to sustainable and regenerative farming. We know that we need to do what we can to lower emissions and enhanced biodiversity. So through that fund and through some of the other schemes that we have, I've talked about the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme and various other funds, that's essentially what we are looking to do, is to encourage the uptake of various different practices and to help fund what can be these pieces of equipment that we know can then have a big impact on emissions.
Finally, in terms of purchasing equipment, obviously the inflationary pressures that we talked about earlier on are a disincentive for all farmers to invest. Is this fund going to be adapting this year to cope with that reality? Is it seeking to help farmers in that situation?
We'll, of course, be looking to take all these factors into consideration as we develop it and before we launch it. And as I said, be happy to keep the committee updated with further information in relation to that. But I do know that, that is going to be a big issue going forward. Again, it would be great to have a bigger capital budget to be able to invest more in that. But unfortunately, we're in the position that we are in relation to the capital allocations that we received. And that's where we are really, what we did in the current financial year is really try to target that where we think it would have the biggest impact on emissions reductions. So, of course, we'll be looking to consider these factors as well as we develop the scheme going forward.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Just before we move on, I'm apologies for harping back at the carbon audits and the soil testing, but I think we all agree how key it is to agriculture moving forward. Given that we're still experiencing a very low uptake, could you come back to us and let us know what your revised expectations of the uptake of soil tests and carbon audits are, and look at, given your engagement with industry, can you give us your a better idea of where you feel improvements can be made to increase the uptake? Would that be something you could do?
I'd be happy to do that. As I say, the forecast spend that we have in relation to that is set at £2 million at the moment, so we would expect that to increase, but I'd be happy to come back to the committee with further information.
Thank you, I appreciate that.
Just also clarity around, you have the National Test Programme that does carbon audits, but you also had the Farm Advisory Service that was doing that as well, and that you mentioned that that fund was exhausted. Are you going to continue with the Farming Advisory Service funding of carbon audits, or are you going to switch and make it all streamlined into the National Test Programme?
Well, I think that that's what has been good about having the National Test Programme there, because I think when the funding for that part of the Farm Advisory Service was exhausted, being able to direct people to the National Test Programme as a means of having that funding. So the contracts for that were due to be up in April of this year, and we've extended the Farm Advisory Service contracts in relation to that as well. So we obviously want to work and make sure that we're not working across each other in relation to the uptake. But of course, if people are going to the Farm Advisory Service, that's one route. But we of course want to see people taking part in the National Test Programme. But that's what I mean, the number of carbon audits that we've seen. I think it's positive that we've seen that exhausted, because I think the amount that they did within that few months was almost as much as what had been undertaken in the whole of the previous year. So I think that shows we're heading in a positive direction in relation to that.
So by having those two different ways, you're creating different kind of doors in a way for people to go through in order to get their carbon audit.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
A very short supplementary.
Yeah, it's actually, I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary and her officials to come back on some of the slurry storage stuff as well, because we know that the AICS funding that you talked about has been cut as well. Only 2% of that is allocated to slurry storage. We know that the farmers have to meet the water regulations, and they only have 4 years to do it, to transition, and one of those years you couldn't get an application for slurry storage. So can we have the figures to the committee of what the criteria will be for the future for the AICS funding? Will it be realistic for farmers from Orkney to the borders to be able to apply for that funding, and will that funding for slurry storage be a higher percentage of the AICS funding?
Yeah, I'd be happy to come back to the committee and outline that information.
Great, thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning and Happy New Year to the Cabinet Secretary and her team. I'd like to ask you a bit about the food processing and the marketing and cooperation scheme. I note that it's suspended for 23-24, but it will be coming back in a new form, and I was just wondering if you can tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I think having it been suspended this year, I know that will be disappointing, because I know that it is obviously a well-utilised fund that we run. I've visited a number of businesses and know a number of businesses that have received funding from that scheme in the past, and again it provides that vital capital injection that a lot of businesses need in relation to their facilities and improvements that they can be making there. But we also know that the scheme hasn't been without its criticisms, and I think one of the key criticisms I've received in relation to the Food Processing Market and Cooperation Grant Scheme, and we touched on this a bit previously as well, is about the windows that we have for spend in relation to that. So for this current financial year, I announced the outcome of the round in November. And of course, there's then a short window. I mean, that money needs to be spent. So it does then leave only a very short window in terms for applicants and successful applicants to be able to spend the funding that they've been awarded. But it's also quite a long process in terms of, you know, for the assessment of that as well, for the scheme. So what we're really wanting to use this period to do is reflect on that, where improvements can be made to the scheme, and fully intend to hopefully bring that scheme back in future years. But we really want to use this period to reflect on that and see, is there a way that we can lengthen that application window, which provides more time for that whole process to be run through, as well as considering questions that, you know, is it accessible enough for small businesses, and really looking at the criteria that we use for that fund. Sorry, George, I don't know, were you looking to come in on that?
Yes, I mean, certainly our hope would be that while there might not be any new allocation in 23-24 mm-hmm. that we might actually be running mm-hmm. an application round right. in 23-24 for money that would then be available from 24-25 so that we give the applicants more time to prepare good quality applications, more time for us to work on them and assess them, and then the full year for the applicants that are successful to make use of it, rather than chasing our tail as we've ended up doing in the last couple of years.
That's really helpful. Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
It's just a quick supplement to that question. Have you done any engagement with people who have used the grant before and gotten feedback from them as to where the shortfalls are in it? Because it's a brilliant scheme and it needs to be, you know, utilised fully. But I've had lots of engagement myself from people saying it's too restrictive, there's not enough money in that particular fund, we can't use it for this. Have you done any engagement with the stakeholders who are actually using the grant or have had used the grant and how to make it better?
Yeah, I think I certainly hear some of that from the businesses that I've engaged with who've been awarded funding, and I think some of the criticisms that there have been of the scheme, and I've talked about the period of time there. I know that that's a particular issue. I think George will probably be closer to some of the detail on that, but I think, again, that's where this period of time is important, because it gives us a chance to reflect on that feedback and look at, well, what changes, if any, need to be made to the scheme to ensure that it is fit for purpose in doing what we would want it to do.
Yes, thanks. In my previous role in food and drink, I actually chaired the assessment panel that decided on the grant, so you know, I had mm-hmm. quite a bit of involvement in this scheme. I think one of the challenges is that it was a one-size-fits-all scheme. It didn't matter whether the applicant was looking for £20,000 or £4 million. Essentially, the process and the requirements was the same for applicants of all size. The requirement, and I would have to say that it wasn't always the case that the larger applications were the better applications. Mm-hmm. There were some, you know, very good quality applications from small businesses. So it wasn't simply a case of you had to get, you know, an advisor to assist to make sure that you got a good application in. But I think all of that is the sort of thing mm-hmm. that we can look at in the course of the year. Do we create a separate channel for you know, the smaller businesses to come forward? Do we create some sort of, you know, sort of two-stage process, as you know, some of the other award schemes have, that people get a first, you know, in principle approval before they then have to go to get their quote? So there are a couple of areas like that that we can look to make it a better experience. But certainly, you know, the feedback that I've had from visiting many of the projects is that, you know, these have made a real difference to businesses and to the communities and the supply chains that they're involved in.
Okay, thank you, Camille.
Can I ask Cabinet Secretary, has any assessment been made of the impact on some of the businesses that are trying to trade out of difficult situations that COVID and whatever? So we're looking at businesses developing. It's going to be over 2 years before funding for the type of business development that we've seen through this before. So is there any, have you got any take on how many businesses might be impacted adversely by a lack of funding for the next over 2 years it's going to be?
Well, first of all, it may not be as long a period as that, because I think, as George Burgess touched on in his response, that we could be looking to open an application round so that the funding would be able to be spent at an earlier stage.
I thought 25?
24.
So the year beginning, so in a year's time, there'll be funding available, or just the application process. So when will actually be money on the table? Are we 24, 25 or 25?
It would be from April 2024.
Right, okay. Yeah.
But of course, I know that people will of course be disappointed if they're not able to apply for a scheme this year. I'm not able to quantify. I don't know how many people, well, in relation to the applications that we saw this year, George, I don't know if you would have the figures in relation to that, in terms of the overall applications that we received for the fund, if that would be helpful.
Yeah, that would be.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is not a precise figure, but I think the number of successful applications this year was somewhere between 20 and 30 of varying scales out of around 50 to 60 applications. So that would give a sense of the number of businesses. Now, actually, if you look at the list of those businesses, which, you know, they're all published for this year and the previous years on the Scottish Government website, you'll see that there are a number of businesses that have been repeat recipients for the scheme over that time. So in terms of the individual businesses that are benefiting, it's probably a slightly smaller number than the overall number of applications.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Cabinet Secretary, going to continue the theme of business development and funding for that. So you mentioned earlier in the session that the Farm Advisory Service Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund is going to continue, because we know that because you talked about the monitor farms. Be interested to hear what else would be supported in that fund.
You mean in relation to the Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund and the types of projects that's been supporting? Yeah, well, I talked about the monitor farms as one of the key projects through that. So that's £1.4 million of funding over the course of the next few years. So that's one of the most significant projects that we'll be funding as a result of that. I'd be happy to come back to the committee with more information as to the allocations that we've made this current financial year and who's been awarded funding. Of course, the Soil Association, I think, have been awarded funding through that scheme as well previously. I visited dairy farms in the south of Scotland where they've utilised that funding as well, because, you know, through the title of the fund about that knowledge and innovation, that's what we're at a time now we really want to see that come forward. And I think it's helped fund some really exciting projects in the past, and I think that the monitor farm is obviously a key part of that, but I look forward to seeing what other applications we get coming forward. But I'd be happy to write to the committee and give more details to some of the successful projects that have been awarded funding through that scheme
That would be interesting to hear. And also, I think we'd be interested to know if the Small Farms Grant Scheme is going to be continued.
Yes, that's one where we're actually undertaking a pilot in relation to that at the moment, because it's one of the only schemes that we've had which is means tested. And I think, you know, from some of the feedback that I've had in relation to that fund as well, it has been challenging for people to apply to. And I think we want to make sure that we've got that support there for small farmers and that support exists. So we're working with SAOS, again, I'm happy to come back to the committee with more information on this, to look to see how we can better provide that support for small farms going forward and actually utilise the funding in a way that works for them.
And when we talk about small farms, what kind of size, what's the smallest amount of land that could, you know, farmers have that they could apply for this fund?
I think, well, that's the thing. It's under development at the moment, and we're working to try and see what improvements can be made in relation to that. I can't remember the exact scheme specifications off the top of my head. I don't know, George, if you would have that information to hand. But again, I'm happy to provide that information. But I know that because of the means testing element, because of who could apply, I think that it was quite a difficult fund for people to get access to. So obviously, we want to improve that and make that better where we can.
I think that would be a welcome. I've been speaking to young farmers, and young farmers tend to be on smaller pieces of land with a lot of passion and ideas for innovation, but then don't really have the capacity to put the time. They're trying to do the work on the land, and then they're finding that the application processes are onerous, and they feel like they need a degree in grant writing in order to access it. So it's good to hear that you're assessing it.
And I think especially for those small businesses, I think that the scheme that we have open, that is probably some of the strictest criteria we have, for one of those schemes, I think isn't fair. But again, that's why we're undertaking this work, to try and see what improvements we can make.
We welcome to hear how that goes. Thank you.
No problem.
Yeah, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Just briefly, you may already have touched on some of this, but last year I think we sought to unpick what financial transactions meant in the budget. And this year, I think business development might be the one that we seek to unpick a bit further. So we're interested to know whether that's the budget that would cover things like the Farm Advisory Service Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund, Small Farms Grant Scheme, and is the support for those areas being continued to the same level under that heading?
Yes, so the support for those schemes is being maintained. So, for example, the Knowledge Transfer Innovation Fund, £2 million, Farm Advisory Service is being funded to £5 million as well. So I think George has the budget line there as to where that falls. But again, I'm happy to come back with more information as to the line that's in and the various different funds that we have, because I can understand from looking at the table and given some of the funds that we've discussed today, just how confusing that can be in the different titles that we have for the funds that then translate to a different title in the budget headings as well, which I know won't be helpful for the committee.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I did warn that it may have been touched on already.
Yeah. No problem.
Jenny Minto.
Well, actually, Convener, I'm not entirely sure I need to ask my question, given the response that the Cabinet Secretary has just given to Alan. And I think what I was specifically going to ask around the financial transactions, what they've been spent on this year and why they've been removed next year.
No problem. I'm happy to elaborate on that as well. And the financial transactions, so the £15 million on financial transactions has been removed this year because that was the loan scheme that we operated. Mm-hmm. So, of course, the committee will be aware that we moved to a system of advanced payments for farmers this year rather than operating a loan scheme, which is far more efficient than what we'd operated previously. And we'd also brought forward the payments within that scheme as well through the SSI that was introduced in September of this year. So we don't have the financial transactions there because we're no longer, we don't need to utilise them.
That's great. Thank you.
Thanks. Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, would you mind if I just ask a question about the FPMC, the food processing?
Yes, absolutely.
Cabinet Secretary, are you concerned, or is the Scottish Government concerned, that there will be a lack of investment in the industry because of that withdrawal? And have you made an assessment of that for the impact that it will have on the farming and food processing sector and the supply chain sector, which, of course, everybody wants to talk about because we want to improve the supply chains rather than withdraw the investment into them. So what is your assessment of that?
I would say that obviously it is disappointing, and I know it will be disappointing for a lot of people that there won't be that fund, but I think it is one of these areas that I think it can also be improved and made a better process for people, which I think why the work that we do over the course of the coming few months and the coming financial year is really important in relation to that, so that we can make those improvements, building on the feedback that we've received and the various criticisms we've received about that fund. But in saying that, I know the impact that it has on a lot of businesses as well, because it's investment that otherwise they may not be able to undertake. So, I mean, some of the businesses that I've visited, as an example, I visited the shellfish marketing group in Bells Hill this year as well, who were awarded funding through that to upgrade their freezing facility. So they're a cooperative for mussel and oyster farmers across Scotland. So of course, you know, that's a huge investment for them, and really important that they get that investment. There's other businesses as well, but it's been about their energy efficiency. So of course, I think this year more than many others, given the increased costs that people are facing, any investment that can be made there would be welcomed, and we want to help with that as much as possible. So if businesses aren't then able to undertake that work, that is going to result in increased costs, and I think especially with the energy costs and the way that that is heading as well. We want to be able to offer that support, but again, we need to make sure that we're doing it in the right way, in a way that works for businesses that are applying to the scheme as well. So I think taking that bit of time to make sure that we get this right is going to be really important.
Okay.
Karen Adam.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, in your opening statement, you touched upon the £14 million increase for Marine Scotland. I was wondering if you could give us a bit more detail on that.
No problem. You're right. There has been a £40 million increase in the budget for Marine Scotland. I mean, the committee will no doubt be aware from the statement from the Cabinet Secretary that was made yesterday about the energy strategy in Scotland and the ambitions that we have in relation to offshore renewables. So the extra increase in funding will help us with the capacity to deal with that, with the planning and consenting. And of course, we do have strong environmental ambitions too, in relation to the HPMA network that we want to roll out as well. So it will help us and enable us to better deal with the offshore renewable element of that work, as well as the environmental considerations too.
It's really quite exciting, actually, how we're progressing this and seeing this moving forward. And I was just wondering, have there been any challenges along the way in planning and organising for this?
Oh, no doubt. I mean, there are many challenges, which is, again, in terms of the resource that we need to deal with that. That's why this uplift in funding is going to be critically important. Mm. I think it is a really exciting time, but it is also a really challenging time as well. I don't think there's any getting around that between the expansion and offshore renewables. I'm looking over to Rachel Hamilton because I know that we've had the event with the SFF as well, and we've talked about the spatial squeeze. There's obviously the HPMA network that I've talked about that we want to roll out as well. So as much as we think we've got a huge marine resource and asset, by the time you factor all these different considerations in, it does become quite a cluttered landscape, which we are obviously trying to manage as best as possible through the work that we're doing with the Blue Economy Vision and the focus that we've put on the outcomes there, as well as the work that will be taken forward through the National Marine Plan too. So again, that's where this extra resource in helping us to be able to deal with all these different issues is going to be really important.
Great, thank you.
The 14 million, obviously, any increase in the budget in subjects that our portfolio covers is to be welcomed. But excuse me, it looks like it's all to facilitate more spatial pressure, so putting more into the sea or restricting fishing. What hope can you give to the fishing industry? Which, as you've already touched on, we heard the concerns about spatial pressures at previous meetings. What hope can you give the fishing industry that their interests will be really looked after when offshore renewables, PAs, increased aquaculture, whatever? These seem to be the headlines when it comes to the 14 million budget. What is there for the fishing industry?
Well, firstly, of course, I'm the fisheries minister and I'm acutely aware of some of the issues that the industry is facing at the moment and that I've touched on in my previous responses as well. But I think one thing that I would continue to highlight is the support that we do have available that we're continuing with in the Marine Fund Scotland as an example of that as well. And I'd also touched on the work that we're taking forward in relation to the blue economy and the outcomes that we have as that in relation to that, because obviously the food that our fishers provide is absolutely vital, and we want to continue to make sure that we're making the most of that. And I think that's also where it's important to remind the committee of the economic link that's been introduced as well, because we also want to see the value from what's caught in Scotland landed into Scotland as well. So of course, that's just because we've touched on the offshore renewables and the HPMA network there, I wouldn't want that or the committee to take from that fisheries isn't equally important within these discussions, because it absolutely is, and it's my role to ensure that it remains as such as well.
Thank you. Peter Wichert.
Thanks, Convener. And you've probably asked some of the question that I was going to ask, but the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that I've already raised concerns about the resourcing of Marine Scotland and the ability to cope with its increasing responsibilities. So what assessment has Marine Scotland made of its operational capability to ensure compliance with the anticipated expansion of marine environment protection? And the Cabinet Secretary is also aware of the concerns of the fishing community that Marine Scotland enforcement targets the UK fishing fleet over other vessels in Scottish waters. So how much of the £14 million budget is to be spent on enforcement in Scottish waters?
I'll ask Ian to come in with some more information on that, but I know that Marine Scotland's working on its delivery plan for the coming year at the moment, so I'll be able to provide more information afterwards. I mean, the enforcement capability that you're talking about is absolutely vital. And the committee will no doubt be aware of the vessels and the capabilities that we have in relation to enforcement. So we have the two aeroplanes, we have three marine protection vessels, two science vessels. We also invested this current financial year in two RIBs, which were in the region of £250,000 for those two as well. So we are continuing to invest in that capability that we have. But even if we were to increase that resource, there's no way that we could still patrol or police the marine environment just because of the across the whole area and the whole coastline of Scotland, just because of the sheer scale of it. So I think I provided the committee with information previously as to how we undertake that enforcement. It is a risk-based system that we use based on different intelligence that we receive, and that then dictates how we task those vessels and where they go to. So I hope that helps provide a bit more information in relation to that. And I think we move to a system of proactively publishing the information in terms of what we're doing in relation to compliance and vessel boardings and things like that too. But I'll hand over to Ian, who might be able to provide some more information there.
Thank you. I think, as Cabinet Secretary said, in terms of our marine operations this year, we are on track to meet our statutory obligations, and Cabinet Secretary provided some detail to committee on that. We are conscious of the ongoing changes with HPMAs coming up and MPAs, and that's why we look to continually review it. And at the moment, we're in the process of reviewing our operations across what is going to be that changing environment. As Cabinet Secretary said, we're already taking steps through the purchase of those two new RIBs to bolster our inshore capability and make sure that we're prepared for the new fisheries management measures and HPMAs.
Thank you. And how much within the sort of the £14 million budget with the enforcement, how much of that are you able to target issues like marine litter?
So we're in the process of finalising our annual delivery plan right now, so we could follow up with detail on the exact spend on that for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
I'm heartened to hear about the two RIBs to bolster the inshore protection, and I think one of the things I'd be interested to understand more fully, and I've read in detail the data and intelligence you use, but to really understand what you mean by a risk-based, you said, system or approach. So it's obviously it's based on intelligence, but I think one of the concerns that I get from stakeholders and coastal communities is that an MPA is encroached upon and the damage is done. And earlier on you talked about the blue economy, and we have a greater understanding that blue carbon is part of our blue economy and protecting that. And it seems to me that we don't at the moment have, and I understand you saying earlier that we couldn't possibly control everything, all of our coastal waters all of the time, but I do have a concern that encroachment happens, damage is done very, very quickly, and the speed with which Marine Scotland enforcement and protection vessels can kind of arrive at a place to stop it from happening is too late for something to have already occurred. So I just wonder what your thinking is about the long term, especially when we're talking about highly protected marine areas where that's inviting a change of behaviour, a change of understanding. And I think that, we're having these conversations because it is all about long-term protection of the fisheries that you, are in support of in your role as fisheries minister. So it's like we're trying to protect the inshore waters so that we have a fisheries for the future. But so enforcement really seems to play a really important role in it. And I just don't think we have yet the capacity to do it properly. But I would like to understand more about this risk-based system.
Absolutely. But I would say to start off that I think one of the key elements that I think will make a difference with that as well, and that will really help us, is in relation to the rollout of REM. So no doubt you'll be aware, and the committee will be aware, of the consultation that we'd had in relation to that. So we're still going through the responses, and of course we'll publish the outcome of that consultation in due course, and our response to that as well. We talked about the rollout of that and the rollout of VMS, which we want to see across all vessels by the end of this parliamentary term as well. But of course, I'll keep the committee updated on that when we publish that information. But I think that extra intelligence is really critical too. I don't know if Ian would maybe want to touch a bit more on the risk-based system, but I mean, we can receive thousands of reports in a year about particular areas. But I would also say from my perspective and some of the cases that I can be contacted about as well, people may see a vessel in an MPA. It depends on the protections that are in place within that MPA. It doesn't always indicate illegal activity, so sometimes the reports that you receive what's happening on the ground can be different now, of course, but we know that there are occasions where that is most definitely not the case, and that's where, if there are particular areas at risk, I imagine that that's where the marine protection vessels would be cased and tasked to on patrol. We also have the aerial surveillance as well, which I think helps with some of that, but Ian, I don't know if you want to go into any further detail or expand on that.
Yeah, in terms of the risk-based system, that's one that we continue to look to improve, and we made improvements to our reporting mechanisms this year so we can get better information from public, and that enables us to start to target our operational capability. As Cabinet Secretary mentioned, that the aerial assets play a key role, in particular in relation to the MPAs, because the vessels that we can deploy obviously have a restriction around how quickly they can get to a certain area, so that enables us to gather evidence. Other technologies as we move forward, and I mentioned we're reviewing our future operational model because it needs to continue to evolve. So REM will play a big part in as we start to move forward, and there'll be probably other technologies we can hopefully start to utilise as we move forward into the HPMAs and MPAs. As I said, I think it's a process of continually building and improving that operational capability. We do have challenges. It's a vast area we need to cover, and getting our response times quicker is key there. And if we've got good intelligence that leads us to the areas of high risk, enables us to be in those areas and on patrol. And as we mentioned, those two new RIBs, a big feature of them is the capability and the speed in which they can now move and shore that we didn't previously have.
And are those RIBs going to be based in particular ports?
No. So in the last year, we've redeployed them to areas of risk. So they've been in East Coast, they've been in the West Coast, and it depends on that risk. We'll then flexibly move them. And I think that is key in terms of our operational capability. We need to be flexible and agile to quickly react to things as well.
You mentioned other technologies. Do you have anything particular when you were talking there? You said REM rollout, but other technology you could probably use in light of HPMAs and MPA protection?
I think at this stage we're exploring and looking at what others are doing in the marine environment as well to start to see what's possible and what we could use. But happy to provide more information on that once we've concluded that work.
Thanks, Convener.
And Adam.
Thank you. Just following on from that, I was just wondering how much of your data collection and evidence-based intelligence really feeds into the operations. For example, the Cabinet Secretary spoke about, you know, people might be in these areas and that might be data collected and reported as somebody breaching, but it might not necessarily be.
So on that, I think as Cabinet Secretary mentioned, we have around about 2,500 intelligence reports per year. A lot of that not because it comes from the public, it comes from our officers and what we spot as well from our vessels and from our coastal offices. Our intelligence team are analysing that on a weekly basis, so they'll then rank and prioritise based on the strength of the information that we've got. So one report wouldn't necessarily mean we would prioritise that as a high priority in terms of our tasking. But what we do is we review our tasking on a weekly basis and we'll then redeploy based on that as we start to move forward. So it is something that's constantly reviewed and constantly updated, and it's about the triangulation of different information coming in and the strength of the information that's coming through on that evidence. Yeah. And happy to provide more detail on some of the information that we get in to give you a sense.
Yeah, it's just quite interesting making that link between the data collected and even the budget setting, you know, it's all intertwined.
Yeah. Thank you.
Peter Swishart.
Thanks, Convener. I was just wondering how can the Marine Fund Scotland be used to help businesses adapt to increasing costs, and I wonder if you could give any examples.
Absolutely. I'm happy to give some examples of that. I think I'd touched on one of the businesses that I'd visited previously in relation to some of the improvements that they've been making in their processing capabilities. So, it's been used for quite a wide variety of things. Some projects that have been taken forward have been in innovation in aquaculture and specific developments there. The business that I visited in relation to the scheme was about increasing freezing capacity at a facility as well. I know that some businesses have been awarded funding to, we've had fish processing businesses applied for, whether that's pieces of filleting equipment to make them more efficient, make their businesses more efficient. And we've also seen businesses apply and be awarded funding for energy efficiency measures as well, which I think, particularly in this climate, we know have a huge impact.
Thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Just expanding on Beatrice Wichert's question there, I think I mentioned it in the Chamber when we had the debate on fishing prior to Christmas recess. The Clyde Fishermen's Trust have prepared a vision for the Clyde fishery. And one of their proposals within that, there was a number of proposals, was looking at harbour infrastructure, modernising vessels, making them more carbon efficient, and also looking at fish processing, having it more localised. Mm-hmm. Just would like to hear your thoughts on that, and if you've got any specific examples further than the ones that you've given Ms Wishart.
Again, I'm happy to come back to the committee and provide the list of projects and the successful applicants that we had to the fund this year, if that would be helpful. There were some changes that were made to the Marine Fund Scotland. I think, you know, it's the second year that we'd run it, and of course I think it's always interesting to get the feedback, and if you are hearing anything particular about the scheme mm-hmm. in relation to if there are further adaptations we need to make to that. We obviously want to make sure that it aligns to our blue economy vision and the ambitions that we have there as well. But again, more than happy to take that feedback forward as well. And we funded about, we know that from the 60 projects we funded this year, so we had the budget of 14.5 million. It also levered in about an extra 39 million as a result of that as well, which of course is a huge amount. In relation to the vision document that you talked about as well, I met with the Clyde Fisheries just before, I think that was in December, where we discussed the vision document. So mm-hmm. currently looking at that at the moment, and I want to go through that in more detail, and I'm obviously keen to work with them and again, but happy to come back and provide you with the specifics on what has been funded through the scheme so far, but also happy to take any suggestions as to how the scheme can be improved for future years.
Great, thank you.
Just before we move on to the last theme, we heard previously that there was a budget cut of over 60 million announced in the autumn, and that included 2.2 million from Marine Scotland, which was savings from enhanced recruitment controls and forecast changes within research programmes. Can you tell us what that actually means practically on the ground?
I'd be happy to come back to you with more detail. I mean, I think some of the other figures that were within that table as well, so we had the 33 million, which was the convergence, but the other, I think around 30 million, I think between Marine and in ARE as well. Yeah, there was a mixture of that, the recruitment controls, yeah, right, across the portfolio. Yeah. I don't know, Ian, you can provide more information in relation to the figure for Marine Scotland.
Yeah, happy to follow up on that and provide more detail. I don't have anything to
say. It's just specifically the 2.2 million within Marine Scotland for recruitment and research programmes that are cut in that. It would be good to find out what that means in practice. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, we realise we're right up our timeline. We're moving on to the final theme, and if with you agreement, we'll continue. Yeah. We're now going to look at supporting islands, and a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I just wondered if you could say something about how the budget deals with some of the big questions facing island communities. In the past, we've often talked about the need for employment opportunities, and clearly those needs are still there. But in a way, the biggest need that's currently facing the islands is the labour shortage mm-hmm. and the connection that has to other areas of policy, such as housing and so on. So I just wonder if you can tell us, what's the budget doing to try and address those problems?
Yeah, no problem. I mean, I think one point I would make from the outset as well is, like you say, it cuts across other portfolio areas. And the island spend that I have within this portfolio isn't exclusively all the island's funding that exists, because, of course, there is this spend from other portfolios as well. And I think when it appeared in front of the committee just before the summer last year in relation to the National Islands Plan, it set out there in our strategic objectives and against each of those objectives, the different work that we're taking forward in relation to each of those areas at the moment. Some of the challenges that you've talked about in particular there, though, in relation to employment. So one scheme that we've had, that we funded so far, we've funded £250,000 for a project together with HIE and with Skills Development Scotland as well, looking at employment and retention on islands. We've also funded a post within UHI looking at how they can strengthen the different connections with key island partners as well in relation to that. So yeah, there's that funding specifically, but again, I'm more than happy to come back with further information and particularly looking across portfolios as well as to some of the other spend that's happening.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And just to follow up on that briefly, you've mentioned there that obviously your portfolio is not everything that's happening in terms of government support in the islands. And you've alluded to trying to work across, if you like, traditional barriers or silos within government. I mean, I think everyone acknowledges that there's plenty of money going in, but obviously there's a need to ensure that we overcome perhaps what's happened at a local level in the past, where houses are built in an area where a school has just been closed, or houses are not built in an area where a school is in danger of closing, and all these interconnected problems. So what do you feel can be done within government, to, not just nationally, but also locally, to overcome these silos and work more closely together to get past these kind of problems that affect the supply of labour?
Yeah, I'd probably bring Erica in at some point as this as well, but I do think that one thing that has been pivotal in trying to overcome that silo operation and ensuring that we have that coherent and that joined up thinking is through having the islands team as well and the work that they do right across government in relation to that. So I don't know, Erica, if you'd want to come in and provide more detail in relation to, I think, particularly some of those issues. I mean, one example I can think of is we're developing remote rural and islands housing action plan as well, and I know that the islands officials have been engaged with housing teams as well. We want to make sure that we're working with communities, so again, we're not experiencing the type of problems that you talked about, but if you're able to bring Erica in to expand on that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, Dr. Allen, so we collaborate very closely with our local authority partners through different forums, such as the Island Strategic Group, and we also have a senior officers group, which consists of British government officials in the islands team and our colleagues in local authorities. And we are able through that group to inform agendas for the island strategic group based on local priorities. So that's one great way of ensuring good collaboration. We also have a National Islands Plan Delivery Group, which consists of a very wide membership across a whole load of organisations that have an interest in delivery of the National Islands Plan. And also we work across Scottish Government teams to try and break down those silos that you were describing there, Dr. Allen, around particular areas such as depopulation, where we're supporting the development of the Rural and Island Housing Action Plan. And my team are also leading on the rural and island part of the Depopulation Action Plan. So there's lots of collaboration going on across Scottish Government and across our local authority areas. And also, I should just say that within the islands team, we each have responsibility for an individual local authority area. So, for example, we have somebody looking after Orkney, somebody looking after Shetland, and that allows us to form really deep relationships with those local authority areas, which is helping very much to inform our work.
Thank you, Convener.
Just, it might be a little bit off script, but touching on rural housing and island housing, we've got a mandate from the government to ensure that all buildings are energy efficient by 2025. Around about 170,000 homes in Scotland are off gas grid, and of those, 40,000 are probably not suitable for installation of air source pumps and things. So that might lead to a situation where people in islands in particular are facing bills of around £30,000 to install heat source pumps, whatever. Have you done any work to look at the impact on rural housing and island housing specifically looking towards a three-year target to have these houses at the highest efficiency levels, and have you made any bids for further funding to your portfolio to address that?
I think if there was to be further funding in relation to that and energy efficiency, and if that's coming to homes, that probably wouldn't fall to my portfolio to fund. I'm happy to follow that up with my government colleagues, though, and come back to you or ask them to write to you with further information in relation to that in particular. But I think that's also where looking at the different strategic objectives that we have within the Islands Plan, ensuring that the annual reports that we bring forward are actions against each of those. We also need to make sure that what we have, that we are dealing with the issues that are of greatest importance to our island communities as well, and we are tackling the problems that they face. So I think it's looking at some of these issues will no doubt form part of that as well.
Thank you. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested to hear a bit about how the budget is helping island communities and residents with increasing cost of living. I know you've you announced a 1.4 million cost budget for that, so if you could give some examples of where that money's been spent and how you expect it to be spent.
Absolutely, no, I'd be happy to, because I think that we know that the cost crisis is affecting obviously everybody across Scotland, but I think it's particularly acute for our for people that live on our islands. And I think that it was kind of brought into sharp focus anyway. I think some of the figures that some of the local authorities had produced, I think, or Beatrice Wishart might know better than me or will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the work that had been done in Shetland showed that you needed to earn about £104,000 a year to not be in fuel poverty, which is shocking. So we knew we had to do something over and above to try and address the particular issues that our island communities face, which is why we'd brought forward and introduced the Islands Emergency Fund. So we provided £1.4 million through that. It's been distributed on a 100% population basis, and that had been determined by COSLA. We wanted to make sure that fund was as easily accessed as possible, so try to reduce the or minimise the criteria that would be needed to apply for that fund, because we obviously want to make sure it's getting to where it needs to go and it's getting out the door as fast as possible. And working with local authorities has been a key part in doing that too. So I think one example that I have in relation to that is, again, coming back to Shetlands, where I know that they're utilising that funding to provide breakfasts to 14,000 children and young people across Shetland Islands. And I think that that's they're planning for that or to run that until March. So that's how they're utilising the funding. But again, I'm happy to come back with more information as to how the funding is being utilised by other local authorities too, if you'd find that helpful.
Yeah, that would be helpful, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you very much. And I think it shows there's been a level of learning from the COVID pandemic as to give local authorities the easiest mechanism to get the funding out. If I may, returning to local authorities, North Ayrshire Local Islands Plan has been given some support. I'm interested to know how you're using that, which I believe has been successful. I think they've created a 10-year island plan in North Ayrshire. How that's being rolled out or being proposed to other councils, like, for example, Argyll and Bute and Highlands, that are a mixture of mainland and island.
Yeah, no, I think that the feedback that we've heard from that has been really positive so far. So I think we'd obviously want to take any learning from that example and share that as best we can, so that I know that officials are looking at the work there and are currently looking at how we can share that good work and that good practice with other authorities, like you say, where there's a mixture as well. So Argyll and Bute and Highlands in particular. So that's something we're actively looking at the moment.
Great. And just, I suppose, touching on the convener's question as well, can you give us an update on carbon neutral islands?
Yes, I'd be happy to provide. I will, of course, be updating Parliament on that and providing more information in relation to that next week. So I'll provide more information there. But obviously, we have £3 million allocated in the budget for that this year. The work has been progressing well. There are initial steps that we've got to get in place. So first of all, looking at carbon audits, and then we want the climate action plans to be produced on the back of that as well. But I think what's been really central to all the work with carbon neutral islands is this isn't something that we're foisting on communities. We very much want it to be community based, working with communities on each of the six islands that we're working with too. But again, I'm happy to provide more information on that when I update Parliament next week.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Just before I move on to the question that I was going to ask, I would just make the point that when we're talking about islands, that without good connectivity links, transport and digital, our islands, they won't thrive. So that's my slight rant over. My question is, can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the Scottish Government has decided to reduce the capital element of the Islands Programme budget in real terms, given the impact of inflation on island capital projects, and that this is funding for which island local authorities will be bidding for in the next round of the Islands Programme?
Yeah, I think just coming back to your first point, I absolutely appreciate what you say about connectivity, and I absolutely understand that. And I think that that's where, it's the spend across other portfolios that is really vital in relation to that, whether that's transport. We know that housing's an issue as well. So we need to make sure that we're tackling these issues. And I think that's where the National Islands Plan really brings all that together to see how we can tackle them as a whole. Really, because there isn't an easy solution to any of this, and we've got to work across the piece in relation to that as well. And sorry, your main question?
It was about the Islands Programme.
Oh, the Islands Programme, yeah. In particular, and the capital allocation. Again, of course, as I've said previously to the committee and throughout the session today, the capital budget is extremely restrained. But again, I think that's where I would highlight that, as I'd said in a previous response to Dr. Allen's question, is that the capital funding that's been allocated, we have the allocation for the Islands Programme this year, isn't the only capital funding that will be going to our islands. So we have the Islands Growth Deal as well. The heads of terms of that were signed in towards the start of 2021, which will see £50 million of Scottish Government funding and £50 million from the UK Government as well in relation to capital funding towards our islands as well. So I think it's important to bear that in mind, that that will be coming forward over the course of the next few years. But of course, given the restrictions that I face within the capital budget, it's really trying to utilise that as best we can. And what we've tried to do for the coming year is make improvements to that programme, particularly based on the feedback and the evidence that the committee had heard. And I hope I'd been able to outline some of the changes that have been made in the letter that I'd sent to committee previously.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
You spoke, Cabinet Secretary, at the beginning of the session about the fact that you're going to be working on multi-year funding allocations for this island programme, and I think we'd be interested to hear a bit about how you're going to go about that to ensure that, certainly in the session we had before, there was concern, before on specifically on islands and the pre-budget scrutiny, there was concerns that communities, organisations apply for the funding and they miss out and then they don't get it. So I think you're talking about doing it. We'd love to hear a bit more about how you're ensuring that multi-year funding.
Absolutely. And I suppose what you mean is like how we're able to develop almost a project pipeline rather than just, I know how challenging it has been, particularly from the feedback that the committee received in previous evidence sessions too. So ultimately, we won't be able to run a multi-annual fund because we do only get the annual allocations. But I think what we are working to do is, as I've talked about previously in relation to some of the schemes, is try to give that certainty and as much clarity as we can about what's going to be coming. And I think that's where, with some of the improvements that we have planned for the Islands Programme, I think should help with that. We're actively looking to see how we can do that over coming years. But I think it's that work that we're engaging with SFT. I think there was a lot of positive feedback the committee received about the engagement with them, given the expertise that they have as well. Working with councils where projects hadn't been successful previously, and I think that ongoing work and development is going to be really key going forward, so that ultimately, as I say, it will be an annual allocation, but we want to try and provide as much certainty as we can.
In what way do you go about providing that certainty?
Again, it is really difficult because the budget is an annual process, so we don't have that certainty until the budget is passed and we receive that annual allocation. I think what we've seen through the resource spending review, the capital spending review, is overall funding envelopes we might hope to receive over that coming period, which gives an indication as to what allocations we might look to have. So we've been through a couple of iterations of the Islands Programme. I think hopefully with the changes that we're proposing for this year, I think hopefully we're maybe getting that balance right in terms of how the scheme is running, and then we can see that continue from here on in, which I hope will help resolve some of those issues.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our list of questions. There are, you've committed to come back to us in quite a number of areas which there's some detail will be welcome, including a timescale for the £61 million to potentially come back into the portfolio. There is a convener's debate on the budget scheduled for the 26th of January, I believe. So a response before then to the committee would be most helpful to inform our contribution in that debate. But thank you very much for your contribution and that of your officials. I'll now suspend the meeting until 10:50. Thank you.